Hello everybody, welcome to my session. The Pragmatic Guide to Search Engine Optimization is WordPress by Franz Enzenhofer. That's me. We start with the usual selfie report. Yeah, it's good.
Okay.
Short about me, my name is Franz Enzenhofer. You can follow me at Enzenhofer on Twitter. Also, you can ask me questions there if I have time later to try to answer them. Okay, about me, I'm doing code like forever. I started building websites in 1998 in a lot of different positions. Code project manager, editor, sales, business development, stuff like this. In 2004, I had my first search engine optimization project, and this time was the Austrian Press Agency.
Since then, since 2006, I calling myself Search Engine Optimizer.
At this point, in 2006, actually I started my own first company. It was called Distribution of Press Information over Blog and Web 2.0 Networks. Today, we call it Corporate Blogging. In 2011, I started the second company, Full Stack Optimization.com. The goal of my company, is to make all SEO companies, including our own, redundant. Also, I did Vienna Jazz, some other companies.
So, to the meat.
Also, I consult a lot of companies in the Austrian, German, and pretty much everywhere. And I really love WordPress. A lot of the startups I'm consulting, I'm telling, hey, just use WordPress. A lot of the big companies I'm consulting, I'm telling, hey, just use WordPress. And I know the different ways how it gets used at these different company sizes. And I wrote the book, Understanding SEO. And there's a whole small chapter about WordPress in it. You should definitely buy it. It's the most awesome book you will ever read. I love WordPress. First of all, we're talking about search engine optimization. This graph, as you see, is when you do search engine optimization. This is how your traffic graph of over WordPress over time should look like for organic traffic via Google. This is my question. Who actually wants a WordPress website here? Every arm, should go. Okay. Whose traffic graph looks like this? Okay. That sounds good. Okay. If you use WordPress as an editorial CMS, you can use WordPress as a lot of different things. But if you use WordPress as an editorial CMS, then you can have this business case is basically you create one target pages, pages that want to get found for something, like articles, but also categories or tag pages. And the more pages that actually want to get found for something, you get more traffic. This website, what we did here, was publishing one article per working day, which means five per week. We published one post, we published another post, and most of them just performed. They actually showed up in Google and got more traffic over time. This is called linear growth. This is what you can easily achieve with WordPress if you keep some things in mind. As you're here in the SEO talk, assume you know what SEO means. SEO search engine optimization is basically the business of getting found. It's all business activities with the goal of getting found online. You can have the perfect website, you can have the perfect WordPress installation, you can have do everything right, and it's not search engine optimized. You can have a beautiful blog, you can have a beautiful blog with a beautiful community, and it's not search engine optimized. Because it's all about getting found. Basically, you have the goal that you want to get found over time. Nobody's forcing anybody to do search engine optimization. Also, when we talk about search engine optimization in the Western market, we are talking about Google. Google is a monopoly for discovering the internet, for searching the internet, everywhere but the Chinese market. There are some talks about that in some markets Google is not a monopoly. This is wrong. Yeah.
Okay. All business activities
with the goal of getting funded. From the book. Search engine optimization, and we are talking now the bridge of the WordPress is coming soon, is playing in these three parts. It's about development, content, and marketing. As it's the internet, you have to do things quite technical. Basically, you need to keep things in mind that about your website, how it's set up, the markup, the technology, so stuff like this. Search engine optimization is also about the content. If you have a very awesome website, which is technically search engine optimized, and you don't have any content, the content sucks, or the content stinks, or the user hates your content, then or it's external duplicate, like you copy paste it from Wikipedia, then the best website in the world technically will not have it. And here's another thing. Marketing. If the people do not click you on the search results because they think you're full of crap, or they do never search your actual brand, like the brand candidate name or the name of the blog, or if nobody ever links to you, then you always underperform, even though that you have good content and you have the technical right setup. So, also, it's a lot of point of view. When, as everybody knows, probably, search engine process is full of dialogue, controversies, and actually full of bullshit. And there's a lot of different point of views. You can view the whole topic, your website, from an development perspective. Like, you only care about that you actually communicate your site to Google. Your page to Google very fast, that Google can actually crawl you, that Google can index you. You can also look at search engines just from the content point of view, like create content that the user really wants, care about, where your words are placed, stuff like this. And you can also see search optimization just as a marketing channel to reach new users. And all of them is a very relevant point. So, when you are This graph is basically the perfect world. This is when at some companies, organizations, or whatever you have in mind, is basically you have an own development team who does the technical stuff, you have a content team who writes the content, and somebody who does marketing. This is probably not the case for most of you here. Sometimes at startup, which also use WordPress, it's all close together, it's like a two people team. One person is telling about the technical stuff, but also about publishing and marketing and what content is possible. And it's all very close together. This can also be search engine optimized. At big companies, at really, really big companies, it sometimes looks like this, that development hates the content, the content teams hates development, and everybody and marketing is against everyone. This one cannot be search engine optimized. And this one I call blogging. This is the normal blog. One person does everything. Everything is mushed up together. Basically means you want to create a blog post, and you want to get found for something, and you think a gallery would be nice, you install a gallery plugin, and this means you do a technical update, and then you publish it via your channels that you have, which is probably Facebook or Twitter or whatever. And so basically everything is just one person. This one can be search engine optimized, but will lead over time to a very crappy website, which sucks. I call this because you start with a very clean website when you start blogging, and then over time you install more plugins, add more stuff, features, whatever you think. You're googling for tips and tricks on the internet, then you change things around, and at the end you end with a big, big block of what was once a pretty good blog, a pretty good website. And this one is very hard to scale. So, the goal, what I'm talking about here, is if you keep some things in mind, then you should be able to have a clean website, which is from a technical point of view, search engine optimized, where you can then start focusing on content and marketing. The thing is, to create a setup and a website where development, the whole development stuff, what's the HTML, the markup, the technical requirements, that the blog must be built, is good enough soft, so that you can actually start focusing where the actual value is. In the content you create and the branding and how you position yourself in the market and in the search results and how you communicate your website and your content out. This is my point of content marketing. If you solve the technical part good enough, at one point you should just focus on content and marketing and don't care anymore about technical search engine optimization. If you keep some simple stuff in mind, WordPress is 80% on-page on-site search engine optimized, and you can focus on content and marketing as you should. Most other CMS systems, you have to actively optimize, and you have to invest a lot of effort, a lot of brain share into actually making it search engine friendly. With WordPress, it's the other way around. With WordPress, you have to actively work to de-optimize it. People still get this done, but it's hard. You actually have to must work to screw it up. I pretty much say you can optimize anything but the type of speed. Anybody uses your type of speed? Don't. Change to WordPress. Just yeah. Okay, what's the simple stuff keep in mind? This is the meat of the talk. The first one is WordPress is a CMS. WordPress, and maybe getting a little bit controversial here, if you use WordPress as a CMS, then you're pretty much good to go. Quite often, people start with WordPress and then some developers or a whole team of developers twist it into something that doesn't resemble WordPress anymore. Basically, create their own fork of WordPress, do unbelievable things to it that nobody could have imagined, but actually they screwed up over time. But if you use WordPress for article generation, but it can also be products, a shop system, anything that is an editorial work, you're very good to go. If you use it as a platform for aggregated content where you funnel stuff from somewhere in there, it gets a little bit tricky. I'm focusing here on the CMS part of WordPress. Okay. Who here uses Yoast? Yoast is a sponsor here, so everybody shows. Who doesn't use the Yoast SEO WordPress plugin? Okay. I love the Yoast SEO WordPress. If in doubt, trust Yoast. It, under the hood, maybe without even knowing it, it does a lot of things with the WordPress installation. And all of them are good. There is a visual part in the editor, which I'm not this one happy, I will just present it now. But under the hood, all the settings possibilities you have, the default settings, the way it creates the site XML, the way basically it communicates the pages in the fastest way possible to Google, it does it right. So we need to use it. Yoast, please also give you this very powerful editor. Basically, where you see actually what you're writing for. In German, they call it the SEO title, the media description, and the URL. And you can change any of these defenses in here, and you actually see what you're writing for. You know the blue link, the URL, and the meta description. This will be your most read text, your most read and seen text on the internet. The thing that you write here will be seen by much more people than will ever be on your blog. Because it's quite common that you have a million impressions in the Google search engine result pages, like it will show up a million times this blue link, and you get 10,000 or 100,000 actually visits from this. But a million people will have seen to some degree this blue link. And within the normal editor, this most important text that will be seen by the most people is actually kind of hidden. We know that it's kind of We know that if you write the headline, this will be set, but it actually doesn't show up here, so you don't see how it can actually look like. And Yoast gives you this one. So this editor is one of the biggest editorial tools for the most important text. And the preview function is just awesome. And any other CMS that is re-implemented this. My hacking with Yoast is the very stupid focus keyword. And English word for the ampel system, this ampel system. The red, green, and yellow rating. You can basically add it in a focus keyword, and then it will scan on your text, and then it gives you a green or some rating if it's actually used enough or not. I hate this. Because the human language is not as simple as looking where stuff is actually positioned. And it doesn't take into account slight variations. So basically, this ampel system, this green, red, yellow rating, is forcing you to repeat the same word in the exact same phrase again and again to actually achieve a green rating. And that's stupid. That's not actually how the English language works, and it's definitely not the way that the German language works. So my recommendation is to ignore it, but use this brief function very heavily.
So, and this is just that is one part of Yoast that is doing. The technical stuff underlying it is much more awesome. Okay, the next thing is the stuff that you need to care about to achieve this linear growth is you need to care about speed. The thing is, Google doesn't like to send slow data traffic as users reuse Google less. Imagine just a scenario like this. There's this banker. There's this banker and he says this big boring Excel sheet. This big unbelievable boring Excel sheet. And then he doesn't want to do this anymore and he has in mind where's the best dinner option near Altersacker. And he's Googling this. Okay, the first thing is, let's say Google is unbelievably fast. Google is faster than a blink of an eye. He gets the results, and he gets the result. Let's imagine basically the site is where he clicks the result. And he clicks the result, and then comes to the page. The page shows up immediately. The banker kind of sees, okay, that's something that I want, or has not interested. If he's not interested, he's bouncing back to Google. Both of these scenarios are completely okay for Google. At the one point, the user got the information he needed on the blog post that he wrote about this topic, or the user just bounces back to Google and clicks something further down, which is not good for you, but it's definitely okay for Google. The second scenario is, the user does this exact same thing. He clicks on the link in the Google search results, comes to the page, and the page loads slowly. There's first this huge header build coming in. The big hero image is coming. Then there's no text. And then suddenly the text starts showing up because of the unbelievable slow font load. And then basically there's a slider coming, stuff like this. If the page loads slowly, there's two scenarios. At one point the user gets annoyed and bounces back to Google, which is bad for you. But the other scenario, this is a much, much worse thing for Google, that the user stops Googling altogether because he's just annoyed and goes back to his Excel sheet. And Google doesn't like this scenario. The risk for Google to sending slow pages traffic is much, much higher than the risk for Google to sending fast pages traffic. And when your site is slow, your content will always underperform. Whatever you do, your content will underperform. You will work a lot and all your effort will be wasted. Basically, some people say, when I talk about search engine optimization, that search engine optimization is frustrating, idiotic, black magic stuff like this. Especially if you do editorial content, that's completely not true. If you are in the green area, like you have a really, 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 really fast website, most of the articles, most of the things that you will publish
will actually perform. They will show up in Google and they will get some initial traffic. If you are in the van area, like this site is really, really slow, most of the content you will publish will just not show up in a relevant way in Google. A search optimization will be hard, will be frustrating, will be hard things that you hate to do. You will start Googling in the internet how to do SEO, and then you will get a lot of stupid information about building links, no-following things, stuff like this. If you are in the green area, you just publish one article after the other, you publish, publish, publish. Most of them will perform, some of them won't, but most of them will just perform. So what does FAST mean? There's different ways how to actually measure this. The easiest way, which I recommend, is PageRank Insight powered by Google. Who knows this tool? Every hand should not. Awesome. Okay. And the important part is here that they should definitely be in the green. And this is not, there are much other tools which are much, much harder, but it's not about reading 99 of 100, but they should definitely be in the green. As soon as you are, I don't know, but on desktop, in the yellow or even in the red area, your site is broken and your content will underperform. You will invest a lot of hard work and it will just not pay off and you will get frustrated with search engine optimization. So, this comes to this point. How to make the site fast? WordPress is actually two things to have in mind to keep, get the site fast. The one thing I love is W3 Total Cache. Who uses this one? Who uses something else, another caching plugin? Who uses, doesn't use the caching plugin at all? Okay. You should use one. We, over time, and during these 3 years, we tested all of them, and I'm a big fan of, of this one. The only thing is, WC Total Cache can put a lot of pressure on your server. So actually, if you have €1 shared web space, then WC Total Cache might not work the way it is, and your site will actually be slower. But if you have a proper hosting, installing this should not be an issue. Okay. Some meat. You will get the slides anyway. Something to be in it. We need to enable page cache, which means basically it will always be a static HTML version delivered. Need to enable minify that all the assets, all the white space, all the crap that you don't need in your market will actually get filtered out. You need to enable browser cache, which means all the assets, the static assets will just be downloaded once, the second page view, the second visit, they will not be downloaded a second time. Check where the revert rules. It's normally not checked. I don't know why. And again, some cache all pages that you actually need. Cache HTTPS. Who is on HTTPS already, Mr. Website? Who is still on HTTP? Awesome. And don't cache for the logged-in user because the editorial will come quite hard. The important part is here, which is mostly forgotten, and this is one of the mistakes, is I don't know why, that cache warning is disabled. Cache warning is the process of pre-caching the pages before Google comes the first time. When Google basically comes to your site, crawls the pages, it makes an estimation. It makes an estimation if you have fast pages or if you don't have fast pages. So, as soon as Google visits the page, there's a request on the post and it will get put into the cache. So whenever a user now comes, the page is fast. But for Google, as Google most of the time was the first request, Google will actually think that the site is slow, that the pages are slow. This one is disabled here. You have to put in a sitemap URL. And because the sitemap URL, there's a wheel starting, basically, and they put in, whenever you change something in your site, all the pages will get put into the cache. When Google comes, that the pages will be already fast.
I don't know why people forget it, but this is one of the most common errors. Other settings, gzip set less modified header set expires header. So that was a catch. This one is the only one which is a little bit more complicated and developers kind of bitch about it. It's that you have to minify and bundle all the CSS assets. CSS is the design information, and all the CSS URLs that you have in here must be put manually there. It's basically that all the CSS get put together in one file. The thing is, a lot of plugins install their own CSS files. So when and then basically this logic doesn't work anymore because you have to do it manually. That's why you can have a very fast site in the beginning, and then you install a plugin, and then suddenly your site becomes slow again. So whenever you install a plugin, you need to identify the CSS and put it in here. This little bit.
If you don't have any technical experience, that's the tricky part. And the same is basically for all the JavaScript.
Whenever you have to put your JavaScript in there, then all the JavaScript gets bundled into one file, a very compressible. Well, for different cases or different page types.
And then you have a big speed impact. Whenever you install a plugin, you might
need to revisit this again. Because very definitely you need to revisit this again and put all the JavaScript files that the plugin actually installed back in there.
Okay. This is the thing in the configuration that you have to mind. Next thing is a fast and slim theme. This is where most of the time WordPress and people using WordPress go wrong. They decide on which theme to use based on functionality that the theme offers, either on the backend side or on the frontend side, and on if it looks good or not. If you want to get found, and this is only if, nobody is forcing you to do search optimization. If you care about getting found and that your content just works, these two things are not as relevant as having a fast site. The user does not care about your design. The user doesn't care about your backend functionality. What the user cares about is the information that you have about the content that you have and that he gets the right answers. This is the search user. Design is important for you to build your own brand. To actually have a product, a website that you like, but for the user, it just isn't. So, whenever you choose a theme, download it. Don't use the demo version, it's the show. Download it, install it. There's some awesome functionality in WordPress where you can have just preview install a theme. Test it, make sure you have the right WC total cache settings. And test them with Google Page Insights. If you're not in a green area with displaying themes or any plugins, don't use it. This is one of the hardest steps. And this is where basically most of the WordPress installation go wrong. Okay. And this one is something. Don't use any other plugins. The thing is, WordPress is very open for plugin what I call it. Basically, you have a very good website, it's a search engine optimized, which is fast, anything, and then you install one plugin after the other, after the other, after the other, and at one point, your site will just stop performing in Google. Because just one evil plugin, which is created by a very passionate developer, but who didn't care about speed, will do something and your site is from a very fast one suddenly very slow again. So whenever you install a plugin, you need to test the pages again. And if the pages are not in the green areas to page with insights, don't use this plugin. Or look again at the W3 total settings. Yep. Okay. Search optimization is really easy when you're in the green area. This is one of the most important things that you can do for your long-term success. The next thing, what search engine optimizers talk about all the time, is about URLs. Why? The URLs, the addresses, of your post. It's in between development. It defines how the plugin is set up. It's part of the component. They use CD addresses. No having intention of space is about, and it's about marketing, because the URL is the thing that you share and will be seen by users first. So it's really in the middle.
And there are some rules about the URLs. First of all,
the URLs must be unique, which means one page, one URL. The URLs must be permanent, so they do not change over time, so there's no dependency. When you change the headline, and there's a good reason to change headlines, the URL doesn't change. The URLs must be manageable. Manageable means you need to be able to separate posts from tag pages, or categories of tag pages, and so on. So you need to be able to realize, just looking at the URL, what kind of page type, what template is behind it.
The URLs must be scalable, so you must be able to create more and more of them over time.
You will always have more pages than your posts than you think. The URLs must be short. And it should include a short variation of the target phrase, which means it should include a short variation of what this page actually wants to get found for. These rules are listed in priority, but also rule number one is more important than 2 to 6 summed up together. Number two is more important than 3, 4, 5, and 6 together. Number 4 is more important than 5 and 6 together. 5 and number 6 is a trade-off. It's not about having the shortest possible URL, but a short URL and with a short variation of the target phrase of this page actually wants to get found for. WordPress does a lot of them right, especially the first one. The URLs in WordPress are unique and they're permanent. There's no dependency when the URL changes. You have to change the URLs yourself, but you can change the headline, you can pretty much change a lot of stuff around, and the URL stays the same.
They are to some degree manageable, they are definitely scalable, they can be short, and they can easily include a short variation of the targeted page. What I'm going in,
when I'm setting up WordPress, I'm going for this schema. If WordPress enables to be seen, I'm using a namespace, a subdirectory, just call it A or B or whatever, I don't care. And then whatever you write in Yoast, the slug that you set yourself. For categories, just use C, and for tag pages, just use B, and for other pages, that's the same. Just a short, single letter namespace. This is something WordPress does not require at the beginning. Do this, that they put the categories in there. Who has the categories in the US? One hands up. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, categories in the US are even. Why? The violate rule number 2, permanent. Permanent means that the URLs do not change over time. When you have categories in the URLs, and you suddenly decide that your category should no longer be called restaurants, but or restaurant reviews, or just be called reviews, and you change these categories, and there's a lot of reasons why you should, why you can or might want to do this, then all the URLs that are posted below this category, in this category, they change too. And whenever you change the URL, basically you're starting from scratch again with this page. There's a lot of ways that you can mitigate this, but it only works 50% of the time. So when whenever you change the URL, and when you change the categories, and you change a lot of URLs, all the pages start from scratch again. You could have gotten a lot of traffic for them. Now you change the URL, basically you're back at zero. So this is the one I'm going for. Also, also they are short. They are short, which is good.
But the thing is, if you already have a good setup blog, and you also get a lot of traffic, don't change the URLs. Only the set one or the other. It usually doesn't pay off to change the URLs, because it's most important that the URLs are unique, which WordPress doesn't take care of, and that they are permanent. And so, don't change the URLs. But if you're new, just go for this direction. And the good thing is, it's pretty easy to set up in WordPress. Okay, internal linking This is something that else that we have to do to care about. I call this the interleaving rules. The most important one is that when you create a page, it needs to have at least one link from another page. I call it targeted page. When you create a post, it should have at least one link from any other page. And when you start clicking from the start page, you start clicking once from the start page, every URL should be reachable. But pagination doesn't count. Yoast again does something smart here, so the pagination counts a little bit, but usually it's not good enough. A search functionality doesn't count. Most of the time, the main navigation, if you have a pop-up navigation, like basically you have a main navigation, you click on it, and then there's an overlay or something, it doesn't count. It's really just about the links that you see on the page without any functionality. And when you start clicking around here, basically it's disabled JavaScript. When you click around, every page should be reachable. And we can now invest a lot of effort and thoughts about how to achieve this, like having an interlinking or creating a big spreadsheet that you make sure that every page has at least one link from another page and is reachable from the start page. Okay, for a minute. Then the easy way is create one simple widget box with five random links, random or all page jumps. Some call it near interessant article, some just put it like this, jump put it on the right hand side. With these five random links, you have up to a million pages, a 98% probability that every page has at least one link from another page, and that every page is reachable from a click pass from the start page. So if you do this, you achieve this very major, the first two, the most important rules, and you can then just don't need to care anymore about internal linking, but you can just do it like you want, like topic specific. But the most important thing is done. It's very, quite often, as the blogs become bigger, as the WordPress setup, as the page becomes bigger, a lot of pages stop performing. Why? Because they are no longer reachable if you start clicking from the start page. And yeah, then it's a lot of wasted work. Okay, if you decide, development is basically done and you can now just focus on content and marketing. You can focus on content and marketing where the value actually is, and this is where your hard work should go to. One thing I have to say, don't care as much about links or link building or whatever they call it. The most successful websites I'm consulting on WordPress pages don't care shit about this whole link building stuff. Okay, I think 5 more minutes. Buy my book. All of them and much more is in there. And yeah, one bonus slide. Is there are 4 SEO tests to which I'm running on every page, and whenever I have a page which is not performing at all, like the really struggling to get any traction in Google, it's because one of these tests fails. This is like certain years of search engine optimization knowledge packed up for this. The one is page insights must be green. Google Mobile Friendly Test, green and sensory screenshot. Sensory screenshot will actually have to see the content. It's pretty easy to achieve green rating this test, but no one sees the content, so that's cheating. Such as Google Bot in the Google Search Console. This is the final test that Google can actually render the site. And also the JavaScript turn off test. The site, the main content, must be visible, the main content must be visible with JavaScript turned off, and everything that will forge should also be visible with JavaScript turned off. And the site must be navigatable, like links must be clickable with JavaScript turned off. Because from a Google perspective, we live in the worst of two possible worlds, which is actually Google is rendering the page like the user sees it, like you see it in your Chrome browser, and Google is not rendering the page and it just sees the HTML markup that's below it. And these are the two views that you have to optimize. And the self-test is actually taking care of this scenario. This is also but often one of the recent things. Okay, I think I'm good. Okay, as I've just seen the sign, I still have more minutes. One more thing, retroactive tagging. Who tags a lot, like gives edit, blog posts, 10, 15 different tags? Stop it, don't do it. What the thing is, every tag page, every unique tag that you give is creating a page, a tag page. And it's quite common that a blog has like 50 articles created and has 1,500 tag pages. Because they think that if I'm tagging it with the right keywords, then I will perform better in some magical universe. It's not, it's creating pages. And all of these pages then quite often have just one blog post teaser on it. So you're creating a lot of duplicates and duplicates and duplicates. And this creates internal competition. It wastes Google's resources. It's not good for anything. What you should do with tags is retroactive tagging. If you basically have like a lot of blog posts which fix a topic, like you've written some videos and they fix the topic travel or travel, then you revisit this post and give them later the tag travel. And then from now on you use this one single tag. And then basically you have a theme page, a topic page for travel, which you can also optimize with Yoast. And this is the way you should do it. You should not create a lot of tags, which creates an unbelievable amount of different pages that nobody cares about. Okay, I'm good. My time is over. How do we deal with questions? Is there one or two questions? Then shoot them. Otherwise, approach me later or tweet some. Yeah.
Well, categories or tags, you just mentioned like retroactive tagging, but when to use categories and when to use tags?
Usually for me, categories are used for navigation and are a fixed set. You don't create 100,000, 100 or even 1,000 different categories. Quite often it's also a one-to-one relationship, like one post has one category. Sometimes there's like two. Where a tag is by definition a one-to-n relationship, like a post can and should be part of all the topic pages, the theme pages it fits. Like you have a theme page travel, you have a theme page England, and the blog post is about traveling in England, then it should be on the theme page and tagged with travel and with England. Whereby in the category it's about hierarchical navigation, so it's usually just in one part. There are some different questions. So another question? Yeah.
I have a question about the category. You have a C and a B before an individual URL. So basically, you use the category in the URL, or how do I understand this?
Yeah, and use in short identifiable namespace so that I know what it's about. But actually, as the URLs must be short, there's just no use there to have category in there. I just use C. So the URL is shorter. Also, as soon as you use a word, even if it's product, it's already a dependency. Because like you have product pages, and you call it product, and at one point you decide, hey, I don't want this to call it product anymore, but shop or whatever, and it's already a dependency, and violates rule number two, that you always must be permanent, because then you might change it in the future. So, go for something that nobody cares about, like single letters. Also, big clients actually in city, we are currently in, and for even them, the single letters are too controversial, so we are giving them numbers for the next phase.
But why don't you leave them out completely?
Manageability. You need to separate the one from the other. At one point, you might want to see how your categories perform, how your posts perform, how your tag pages performing. And then you need to be able to filter them in the Google Search Console and Google Analytics, so you can look at the subsection of your page. So giving them a namespace, you can separate one from the other, and then you can optimize them separately. Also, you can, with these namespaces, you can submit them to Google Search Console. And with the namespaces, so you have all the information that you normally have about just the whole site,
you can have different subsections. So you see how the subjects is performing from all the matrix that you get from the research and so on. I think time's over, you can approach me for questions for some time. Also, I have three books if you want to buy them, that's 25 euros. Otherwise, visit our awesome website, it's the best book and the best investment you will ever do. Okay, thanks a lot.